Getting better.
My shofar is broken.
Getting better.
Let me key in the worship of
Bye.
Thank you. Can you hear me there? Yeah, you sure can. Welcome. Hello, hello. Shalom. Man, it's been a long week already, huh? Man, oh man. Well, let's start out with a word of prayer. This place filled with the Spirit, and we just got ourselves inundated with, you know, beautiful music, great worship. And I'll tell you right now, you should be filled inside with the Spirit. But everybody seems kind of like, ooh, you know. Let's go ahead and pray. Dear Lord, I just want to thank you so much for your great love for us, Father. And I'm thankful tonight that you have come to this house and you have brought, you know, all your children here tonight. Father, we just ask that you be with us and that you would share your love and share your understanding and help us to continue to grow closer to you, to walk more in your Torah, and to be ready for all things that have to come. We pray these things in the mighty name of Yeshua HaMashiach. And everybody says,
Amen. Amen.
Let's go ahead and do the Shema. Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem Tov, Malchuto, Le'olam Vayeh. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. Blessed is the name and glory is seen forever and ever. Adonai, Adonai, Yeshua HaMashiach, who art thou. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu, Yeshua HaMashiach, who art thou. Lord, Lord, Yeshua the Messiah, He is Lord. Blessed are you, Lord God, Yeshua the Messiah, for He is Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated. And turn the lights on so people can see. And that concludes me. Tonight, I am here to lead you in this Torah study. So don't be too surprised. Our rabbi was invited to a wedding in Puerto Rico. And him, his wife, and... Sorry, Alex, your wife too. That's the way it goes. You gotta take a good with bad. I don't know how much you guys have been paying attention to what's going on in the world, but right now it's getting a little crazy in Israel. I was just reading in the news today where people are like, Palestinians are coming out left and right, and they're attacking the Israelites. I mean, just yesterday, a guy was stabbed in front of the police station. Can you imagine? I mean, seriously injured. And, you know, of course, they caught the perpetrator, but the bottom line is going on crazy. And the mayor of Israel, of Jerusalem, he flat out says, if you are, you know, if you have a license to carry a gun, you need to carry a gun. I mean, it's getting serious. So I tell you right now, we need to continue to pray for our brothers in Israel and lift them up in prayer. Because the times are among us, you know? And it's not a thing for fear, it's a thing for prayer.
Amen.
Right? Because our God is in control.
Amen.
And that's the truth. tonight I'm here to open up with the Torah. And it's the very first Torah of the year. We're going to go right back to Genesis. And I know there's a lot of things I'm going to say tonight that you probably have heard. But the truth of the matter is, what does God command us? To go through these Torah readings every year. Because there's always something new. There's always something to bring us closer. There's something that we need to hear again.
Amen.
So, let's, with that understanding, and for you, Harlan, this is in the beginning.
Thank
you. Got it? Tried to cover all bases now. But, with that, I will start. This, the word today is Bereshit. Okay? And you know that the rabbis taught a lesson on this word not too far in the distant past. And it's really kind of cool because, you know, he did this great study, this great study on the Bereshit. You know, this word is broken into, you know, seven letters that break into these words. And there's seven words, and these seven words break into a message. And it's just the most phenomenal thing. You know, so they take these letters and they come up with these words, Bereshit, Bara, Elohim, Et, Hashamayim, Va'et, and Ha'aretz. And in those words, right,
In those words, they're days. They kind of represent the 7,000-year plan of redemption. I always thought it was interesting when he talked about it because the fourth word represents this et, you know? And the rabbi always says that when they translated the Hebrew to English, they didn't have an English word for that one. But it's really the Alpha and Tau, right? It's Yeshua. He's in the beginning, he's in the end. So what they did was they took Yeshua out of the Torah, pretty much so. You know, and it's kind of interesting because that word also represents the fourth day, and it also shows that he was coming on the fourth day or the fourth of the year.
Amen.
The sixth one is the Vayet. The Vayet means he's coming again. So when you look at this first word, it's like, wow. You know? I mean, God literally has a message in almost every single detail of his word. And you know, it's just sitting there for us to look into. I mean, you've heard the thing, you know, it confounds the wise of the world. Why? Because they read it literally, right? But to those who will study, those who will search, he will open our eyes, right?
Amen.
He will open our eyes and become wisdom to us. So you got to remember that. And I will tell you right now, if you haven't heard that message, I really highly recommend that you go into the archives and go ahead and get it. It's some really good stuff, really good stuff. All right, the Torah reading this week happens to be Genesis 1:1 through 6:8. And trust me, there's a lot in those scriptures. You know, it's amazing that we're supposed to cover all that in one Torah reading. And it's obviously, you know, you can't cover everything or to the depth that you want to. But I was looking over Rabbi's notes, and I'll tell you right now, it's really, you know, phenomenal because after looking at his notes, you can tell why he only ever gets through his intro. You know, he's got so much stuff in there. You know, but it's really, really good. You know, the thing is here, it's about creation, right? We know that. And when you think about creation, many, many, many thoughts go through your head. But one of the main things Rabbi wanted me to put out was, in the front end here, is that this creation is not random, okay? It's not just, God just threw it together. Every bit of this creation has purpose. You know, God has a plan in the whole thing. It's like, you know, a huge classroom which God is taking us, you know, through seven, you know, specific covenants. You think about it. There's seven covenants go across the entire word, right? But in the very first of the seven covenants, also look at the 7,000-year plan of redemption. I mean, each one of these is a step for him to point at us, to like a billboard, you know, like, hey, I'm trying to wake you up. I'm trying to show you my path. So, you know, basically he says creation, in the message of creation, God provided or established a political or a governmental kind of system, right? Adam was given with the entire earth, right? And he was given the earth and all of it, established self-governing systems. God fellowshipped with man. He fellowshipped with Adam. He put Adam in this earth. He gave him the entire earth, and then he fellowshipped with him. And then when he fellowshipped with him, he gave him the Torah verbally, right? So then he goes on, he says, okay, guess what, Adam, I'm going to tell you, I want you to go ahead and take dominion over everything. So basically he made Adam sovereign. And that's a big step, that's a big thing when you think about it, because he placed Adam over everything. And that's the same thing that really he's trying to get back to us. So the goal here, creation, was to get us from when we fell down from the garden, back to the garden. And we're supposed to use the Torah as our means of our path. Tell you another thing. Standing up here and talking for an hour is a little different than 15 minutes. But we're going to get there. And of course, we know what happened, right? Adam was made sovereign. He was made a king over the earth, right? Yahweh being king of kings, right? But in his sovereignty, what did he do? Well, he made a silly, selfish decision, and he blew it. You know? But ponder this for a split second. You know, the idea that God knew, even in the very first word, God knew Adam was going to fall. You know? I mean, realize he knew it. And he had to lay the entire plan of redemption out, knowing that Adam was made perfect and given just about everything was going to fall. I thought that was kind of interesting, but in that emotion, you can understand why the Torah became very valuable, because the Torah is the government, right? And we've been given this government, it's got rules and regulations, and you see, as you plug into this government, if you plug into the understanding of how the government operates, then you get the same power on how to operate this government. And that's why it's so critically important that we all study. We all know these principles, because everything is based on these principles. And that's what we're going to study a little bit more here when we start looking at the actual creation or the framework of the of all creation. So with that, when we kind of walk into the Torah and we're doing it properly, in actuality, God gave us authority. He gives us authority to stand over things. And that's another reason why you have to know the government, because he gives us authority to do what? To break curses. He gives us authority to walk forward. He gives us authority to stand as he would have us to stand. But you can't do that if you don't first realize that you have that power, or that strength, or that ability. And it doesn't come freely. I mean, it comes because of what? Obedience. Right? Through obedience, we get the blessing. But anyway, don't let anybody tell you that you know, this Torah is not valuable, because there's a lot of value in this Torah. It's a tremendous amount. So anyway, so now you understand the purpose, the original purpose of design is that God has a 7,000 year plan of redemption. He's taken us from the fall of the garden all the way back to the garden. And we are getting very close to that point, because we're at year 6,000, the end of 6,000 right now. You know, we are right on the precipice. So that's another reason for us to really dig in and jump a little deeper. Let's go ahead and turn to John chapter 1. We're going to read verses 1 and 2 and verse 14. He existed in the beginning with God. He existed in the beginning with God. All right, let's jump to 14. So the Word became human and made his home among us. He was full of the unfailing love and faithfulness, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the Father, the one and only Son. Now, when you read these words, I know everybody in this room, has read these words before. You know, they were like the paramount point, even when you're walking in the green mindset, you know. I mean, the Word became flesh. But most people don't think about what Word, especially in the Greek mindset, what Word? They just think of the Bible, right? But the only Word written then was the Torah and the Tanakh. So he was talking about how Yeshua is the living Torah. And the living Torah lives with us. He came to be with us as man. And he was the guarantor of our covenant unto salvation. And Yeshua is a living covenant that let no man tell you that this Torah is not valuable. I mean, because, you know, this Torah is really everything. That's why I keep emphasizing, because at the very beginning, God is really pointing to this government. And that's the message here, it's the government that we need to walk in. But a good scripture to memorize is Matthew 5, 17 through 20. And let's turn there real quick. But I know you guys have heard this scripture before too, but this scripture is outstanding. And you're going to hear people, they're going to look at you, and they're going to say, especially if you're talking about Torah, they're going to look at you and say, you know, really, that's past. You know, that's not really for today. You know, you kind of have misinterpreted everything. But you go straight to the scripture, and you can look at the scripture in Matthew 5:17. It says, don't misunderstand why I've come. I did not come to abolish the law of Moses or the writings of the prophets. I did not come to abolish the law of Moses. Or the prophets. Right there, he spits right out. No, I came to accomplish their purpose. Mm-hmm. Amen. Interesting, huh? I tell you this truth. Heaven and earth will disappear, but not even the smallest detail of God's law will disappear until its purpose is achieved. So if you ignore the least commandment and teach others to do the same, you will be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But anyone who obeys God's law and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of God. So he's saying, you know, if you teach against this Torah, well, he's not saying you won't go to heaven, but he said you're going to be the least. But we're looking at something here. We're actually walking in the Torah. We're going to be God's remnant. And I know, even to me, it's like, well, I know that means something. You know, as Rabbi says, he wants to be sitting right there on the table, you know, at the celebration table. He wants to be saying, hey, Moses, how you doing over there? And that's what we're going to be. We're going to be in the inner side, because everyone of these Christians who receive Christ, they're going to go to heaven. You know, they're going to continue on with, you know, with God's plan. But the thing is, we're going to be in that inner core with them, you know? And they're going to be in possession, but we're going to be the ruling possession. I mean, there's a lot that comes with this thing, and I can't really go into the depths of it, because, I mean, I don't even understand it that well. But I'll tell you right now, what we're doing, that God has touched your heart and opened your eyes through the Spirit to this door, you should feel blessed.
Amen.
Blessed beyond measure. This is good stuff. All right, moving on. All right, let's go back to Genesis chapter 1 through 5. And let's take a look at this creation. Alrighty, it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and empty, and darkness covered the deep waters, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters. Then God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw that the light was good. Then he separated the light from the darkness, and God called the light day and the darkness night. And the evening passed, and the morning came, marking the first day. Now, on this first day, you can see God's laying out the elements, right? He's got the earth, he's got the void, he's got darkness, he's got water, and of course, God. And you know, it's kind of funny, because then he says, and let there be light. You know? But the big thing, what is God saying here? He said, I separated the light from the dark. Now, I don't know about you, but you can walk into a dark room and you turn the light on, you ain't separating dark on one side, on the other. It kind of goes everywhere. So the bigger meaning with this is God's telling us, right? He's telling us we need to realize there's a separation point.
Amen.
And he talks about this throughout the Word of God. You know? I mean, throughout the Word of God, he says, you know, good from evil, right? Holy from unholy, clean from unclean. You know, I can't read those words. Those are my words. heaven from hell. And life from eternal separation. I said, you know, the thing is, for all eternity, for all eternity, he will separate this darkness, right? He separated this darkness so his light will come and shine for us. We will shine in his light. But that's the main point. It's one of the first foundational statements God says. All right, let's go on to the next one. It's Genesis 6 through 8. And it says here, yeah. Then God said, let there be space between the waters to separate the waters of the heavens from the waters of the earth. And that is what happened. God made this space and separated the waters of the earth from the waters of the heavens. And God called the space sky. And the evening and the morning passed on the second day. Now that seems kind of quick. But you know, physically, what is he saying? He's saying he put the sky there, he put the waters above, there's moisture in the air, and there's water on the ground. But we all know God's talking more than that. And you know, when you look at it, what's in the heavenlies, right? We look at water, we look at the Spirit. So he's separating the spiritual realm from this physical realm. You know, we're not going to intermingle. Like, you know, it's not like we're going to be talking to Moses even though he's dead, right? It just doesn't happen like that. He's separating these realms. So the first step, you can see what he happened. He said light from dark. Now he's separating the realms of spiritual realm from an earthly realm, right? Or physical realm. All right, let's go on to 9 through 13. Then God said, let the waters beneath the sky flow together into one place, so dry ground may appear. And that is what happened. And God called the dry ground land, and the waters seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let the land sprout with vegetation, every sort of seed-bearing plant, the trees that grow, the seeds bearing fruit. These seeds will then produce the kind of plants and trees from which they came. And that is what happened. The land produced vegetation, all sorts of seed-bearing plants and trees with seed-bearing fruit. Their seeds produced plants and trees in the same kind. And God saw that it was good. And the evening passed and the morning came, making the third day. Now, here's another one, right? He's separating the water from the land. He's talking about two physical functions, right? Land is obviously what? That's where God's creating all these substances from, right? And the water is representing the life, because you can't have plants without water, right? Or you, for instance, you could go many, many weeks without eating food, but you can't go but a couple of days without water. Water is the lifeblood, right? It really is. When you think about it, it's bulk everything. So what God's doing is separating this. But I think really, when you have to look at this, I mean, me being an engineer, I've got to look at these from an engineering point of view. Really what he's setting up the automatic system, you know? It don't require any man to be here, right? You can wipe out a whole field and come back in 3 years and it'll be covered with grass and starting with trees and all sorts of other things. This system is automatic. And God says, this is the next portion. It's the next portion of my framework of this creation. So with that, let's go on to the next one. This is the day four. Now it's interesting because right now we have three frames. We have light and dark. We have spiritual realm, physical realm. We have the substance of life, how it continues on with water and dirt. Now these are three systems, but there's one more now God has to do. He wants to communicate with us, right? So let's go ahead and read 14 through 19. Then God said, let lights appear in the sky to separate the day from the night, and let the signs, and let them be signs to mark the seasons, days, and years. Let these lights in the sky shine down on the earth. And that is what happened. God made two great lights, the larger one to govern the day and the smaller one to govern the night. He also made the stars. God set these lights in the sky to light the earth, to govern the day and night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And evening passed and morning came, marking the fourth day. Now, when you look at this, this is really a form of communication. Now, we all know that God's about appointed times, right? He has appointed times. Why? Because he wants us to restore. He wants us to come back here right with him so he can shower us with blessings. So that's why he's given us. He's given us a time clock. And then we also know that he does signs and wonders in the skies, like the four blood moons, right? We know over history, we can see that on these blood moons, significant events have happened. And it may take us, you know, a year or so before we realize what this one's going to be. But still, God is talking to us. These are the means that God uses. And I thought it was kind of interesting because now that he's covered, you know, the framework of what he's doing spiritually and physically, he now has this communication plan, right? So little by little, you can see, you know, we're getting to the point of the framework of all creation. So let's go on. Let's go to the next one, 20 to 25. Then God said, let the waters swarm with fish and other life, and let the skies be filled with birds of every kind. So God created the great sea creatures and every living thing that scurries and swarms in the water, and every sort of birds, each producing offspring of the same kind, and God saw that it was good. Then God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply. Let the fish fill the seas, and let the birds multiply on the earth. And evening passed, the morning came, marking the fifth day. Let's go on to verse 25 here. It says, then God said, let the earth produce every sort of animal, each producing offspring of the same kind, livestock, small animals that scurry along the ground, and wild animals. And that is what happened. God made them all sorts of wild animals, livestock, and small animals, each able to produce the offspring of the same kind. And God saw that it was good. Now, I read it to the sixth day because here we have birds, fish, right? They came first. Obviously, we don't have wings. We're not flying with birds. And obviously, we don't have the ability to swim under the water and breathe without, you know, some sort of apparatus. But they came first, and then God showed the animals. And then the question comes up, why the animals first? Why didn't he create man first, right? And I'm not sure if you might have asked that, but I've heard that question before too, and I've asked it. But it's funny because I heard Rabbi say this, and he said flat out, he said man has an animalistic nature. So that's why the animals had to come first, because the animals are here, and guess what? When we start with an animalistic nature. So what does God do? He shows us through the offerings, right? What our sin does, we have to have these offerings where we sacrifice the animals. Well, in that, we're supposed to recognize that, you know, the pain and suffering that the sin caused, that we had to sacrifice these animals. In that same sense, God's trying to tell us that it's our animalistic nature that has to die as well. So that's the whole point. We have to die to this animalistic nature. And, you know, it's funny because, you know, when you're born, right, you know, you see a little kid, you don't have to teach a little kid how to be bad. You know, they figure that out real fast. but as they grow up, right, what happens? They start, you know, they start becoming educated. They start taming that animalistic nature, right? Of course, then become full adults, right? Adults. But you know as well as I do, you know, some are tamed more than others, you know? And I think that's why these offerings had to come, because the sin is still there. And the more we see our sin or the results of our sin, the more we realize, hey, you know something? This stuff ain't good. And so God says, yeah, you have this animalistic nature, and it has to be killed. So, with that, let me see where my notes stick now. Okay, now to this one, verse 28. So then God blessed them. Oh no, let's go down there, sorry, I went too far. Verse 26. Then God said, let us make human beings in our image to be like us. They will reign over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, the livestock, and all the wild animals on the earth, and the small animals that scurry along the ground. So God created human beings in his own image, and the image of God, he created them, male and female. And we'll come back to that in a second, but interesting enough that, you know, God, he created this guy out of the dust of the earth. And you know how it says he breathed into him. And he breathed into his nostrils life. That's not man, oh man. You know, God is spirit, right? And yet he breathed into him his life. Like, wow, that's really unique. But that's the end of the sixth day. So we're going to come back to man in a second. But what I want to talk to next one is really about the seventh day. And the seventh day is very interesting. Let's go ahead and read it. It's chapter 2, verse 1. It says, so in the creation of heaven and earth, and everything... In the creation of heaven and earth, and everything in them was completed on the seventh day that God had finished his work of creation, so he rested from all his work. Here it is. And God blessed the seventh day and declared it holy because it was the day when he rested from all his work of creation. Mm-hmm. Now, the reason why this is interesting to me is, I was brought up in the Greek mindset. You know, the idea of Sunday worship was what we were brought into. It was a tradition, right? And we all got in there, but why wasn't it ever emphasized? I'm not sure. But when you look at this and you realize what God's doing, this is creation. Okay? And he's establishing the foundations. He's establishing all the framework here. Mm-hmm. And he says to us, the seventh day is a day of rest. Right? The day we're supposed to be separating ourselves from the world. Now, of course, in the mindset of most people, you know, when they hear rest, what do they think? You know, let's go, you know, siesta, man. It's time to put the feet up and watch a football game, relax, right? But God's not talking that. God's talking about rest, meaning coming back to him, right? Coming back into him where he can replenish you, where he can recharge your engines, where he can fill your life the way it's supposed to be so you can go back out into the world and do the fight you need to do. And it's interesting because without that, you know, you stop coming here for a few weeks and see how your life goes. You ever done that before? You ever just like, got so busy I couldn't make it, you know, two or three Saturdays in a row? And you just start realizing, you feel this heaviness. Mm-hmm. You feel this like you're getting bogged down. And it's real. It's very real. Especially, you know, since God has touched your lives, I mean, you are his child. And trust me, you're going to feel it more than anybody. Mm-hmm. And it's really true. God says, come back here. And he's not talking about, you know, Friday night, you do the Shabbat. You know what I mean? You relax, right? And that, we love each other. We fellowship. And it's really a time of love, right? And then Saturday, you know, what do? You get up and you run to the store. You go shopping. No. You know what I mean? You should be waking up and keeping it a time of holiness. Amen. And you know something? You may not know what to do, right? I don't know. What can I do? I don't know what to do. I'll tell you what. Why don't you ask God? Amen. Right? Amen. I mean, really, if you have the heart and you want to serve God, then do it. But you know something? You're not alone. So don't ever feel alone. Ask God. Be sincere. And he will guide you down that path. You know, for instance, for me, I take that morning, I study. You know, it's a great time to rip open the Torah, man, really dig into it, you know. And before you know it, you'd be surprised how much time has passed. And then you pray, you know. But you have different things. You should be playing good music. I mean, not everybody's perfect in this. I'm not saying you have to be this ultimate perfect. But I'm saying your direction and the motivation of your heart has to be in that path. You know, we should be coming back to rest so he can refresh us. And that's the whole goal. All right. Let's see. Got that covered. Got that covered. I'll tell you what, you know, putting together a little 15-minute thing, no big deal. How he puts a whole hour together, I'm like, wow. All right. That's pretty much most of creation we just talked about. Okay, you see the framework? I mean, the framework, look at the God separates dark from light. Well, that's more spiritual, right? Then he separates heavens from earthly, right? Spiritual from physical. That's the framework, right? And then we see, you know, this natural action that we have, growth just happens. We have nothing to do with it. So we have this sustainability of this planet that just stays going. Nothing about it, right? Oxygen is developed, plants grow, you know, the whole thing processes. Then he brings in animals. Well, okay, that's nice. But, you know, okay, brings the birds and the fish. We can't do anything with those because they're too far from us. We can eat them, I mean, no doubt. but then he brings in the cattle, right? And then he starts talking about, you know, hey, what's the purpose of this? Well, then we find out the purpose of this is because we need to see who we are, right? And then you go through that whole process. He creates man. You know, so the 6 day he created man and woman, right? So we know that's the time frame when that happened. But then he tells them what? He tells them, guess what? Take dominion over everything. I want you to govern it. So he gives us sovereignty. And then, of course, he rests. So you can see this framework. God was establishing a boundary, kind of like, you know? I mean, you put a building together, you got to put a framework up, right? Well, this is the framework of creation. And in that, then he walks with Adam. And guess what? He gives him the verbal Torah. I mean, let's face it, Adam was about as perfect as can be. I mean, he's supposed to live forever, live for eternity, right? And then, even after he screwed up, he almost lived 900 years, right? So he had this perfect body. And I don't think he needed it in written form, you know? I think when he fellowshiped with God directly, he got the whole Torah. I mean, there's no doubt about it. And he had that Torah, he had the earth, he had the foundation, everything was perfect, you know? And that's the picture we have. Then we go on, then we go a little further. And the further is like, there's like all these other big topics. We have creation of man, we have the Edomic, or the covenant of Eden. We have the creation of women. We have the fall. We have Cain and Abel, right? We have Cain's line and the new son. And then we have a little discussion about the 10 generations. With that, let's go ahead and try and cover some of this throughout this thing. Each one of these things, I looked at it when I first looked at it, I'm looking at it, scratching my head. I'll tell you. I mean, the amount of notes he has in this thing is phenomenal. And what you can talk about in this stuff is really, really deep. But, you know, he has like a lot more time to prepare for this, I'm sure. But this is tough, man. I was like, wow. I mean, I have all the respect in the world for Rabbi. I mean, if you ever have to stand up here for an hour, and he does it every weekend. He just spits around on top of his head like it's nothing. But I'll tell you, you know, it's a lot that he has in his mind and his time. He's studied. Yeah. And if you do something like this, you have a whole new, you know, awe and respect for the amount of effort he puts into what he does. With that, let's go ahead and turn to Genesis 1. 26a, and let's reread that. It says, yeah. Then God said, let us make human beings in our image to be like us. And I thought, that's pretty interesting, you know? He said he made man to be in God's image, right? Mm-hmm. Well, are we not men? Right? Look around. You see God's image? I mean, look in the eyes of others. You see God's image? I mean, you know, Frank's not here, but you know, I mean, well, I see a lot of dirt bags, right? You know, we're just creation of dirt, but the image of God, right? I mean, come on. So it's funny, you know, you go to the Word of God, though, and the Word of God says his image is more like, you know, the tabernacle in the wilderness, sacrifice, deliverance, the Lord of the Sabbath, author of the commandments, the guarantor of covenants, the color of the rainbow, the prince of peace, the way, the truth, and the life. He's the king of kings. He's joy. He's peace. He's comfort. You know, he's love, right? When you think about these characteristics, that's what you're supposed to see is God's image, you know? And so when you look around at each other and you look deep enough in each other's eyes, you know, you will see some of these things. You have to. Because he's imprinted his image in each one of us. So it's got to be in there. You may have to struggle to look for it a little bit, but, but it's there, trust me. in these things, you know, it's interesting that if you look hard enough, you'll see it. But I will say this, and each one of us, and each one of us is a special, we are a special creation, okay? God loves us intently. And we should understand that we should feel special. Because he really is just, you know, you ever think about when you first fall in love, right? You have this crazy, crazy love, right? That's how God is with us. He's crazy love about us. And we have no concept a lot of times of it, you know, because we're so, oh my God, you know, we have so much of this awe upon our lives. We don't need awe. We realize that God loves us. That's really a good thing. So much that he imprinted himself upon us, and he lives inside of us. The covenant of Eden. All right, what's the next topic? It says here that you will, you know something, you're going to hear they call the Edenic covenant, right? So what is this covenant? I love this covenant because it's the first one, and it really gives you a good understanding of what is a basic, you know, framework of covenant, right? So all covenants, you know, they have two parties typically, okay? And the one is the greater, the provider, and the title of that one is called the suzerain. He's the suzerain of the agreement. And the other is the lesser, the one that requires, you know, more assistance of the greater. And his title is the vassal. And this agreement is called a suzerain vassal agreement, okay? And the suzerain agreement for the Garden of Eden is pretty evident, you know? I mean, God provided the Garden of Eden, God provided eternal life, he provided fellowship, right? And the vassal, Adam, what was he told? Of all these trees, do not eat of this one. That was it. You know, not a real complicated thing here. You know, and people look at this and, okay, well, is that like a contract? Well, no, it's not a contract because, you know, if I make a contract for a house with a bank, I mean, they're not intimately related to me. But see, God is intimately related with Adam. And God says, I have all, and I will give for you, right? So you can see this is where it becomes covenant or agreement. And in that process, you know, I mean, the greater has everything. And that's why he gives to us. And that framework is something you're going to see repeated multiple times. Let's see, the problem with this covenant, though, this Edenic covenant, is, of course, man falls. Man makes a mistake, right? The fall of man. So this one here, I'm not going to go too deep into because I know Rabbi just covered this, but yes, the woman was gone. Yes, she ate the fruit first, no doubt. But no, she really wasn't at fault. When you think about this really deeply. Okay, first off, where was the man? Where was the man? Where was he? I mean, come on, man. You men want to be followed. You men want to lead. You men want to be considered men, right? Guess what? Then be a man and realize, accept the fact that Adam was at fault. Okay? Let me look at it. Why did he let Eve get even near the tree? Right? Why did he let Eve even look longingly at the tree? You know, why did Lady Eve reach out to the tree, right? And then, worst part of all, is why did he follow Eve and take her by the apple? Why? I mean, you think about it, you know, even if Adam wasn't around those first three, you know, maybe he was, you know, off somewhere with God and Eve was looking at the tree and she looked at him and pondered it and she reached out and grabbed it. You know, maybe he wasn't there, but still the bottom line comes down to what? He ate of the fruit too. I mean, that's the bottom line. Think about it. God said to Adam, you know, he said, Adam, do not, right? Directly to him, do not. So, you know, the bottom line is why? Because you will die. You will die. So it was upon Adam to ensure Eve understood the process thoroughly. But even if he did that, he still ate of the tree. He blew it, you know? I know you've heard Rabbi talking the exact same thing. I mean, the man should have been there to say no, or should have said no, or at least should not have ate after it. You know, he should have went to God and said, listen, what do I do now? This woman's all kind of messed up. But he didn't do any of that. He fell right down with her. Now realize, you know, that Adam and Eve, this is the part that I really wanted to get to, and I didn't read too much on that one, but I really wanted to get to this because this is what struck me, is that Adam and Eve were basically perfect. You know, they were perfect creations. There was no corruption put upon them. There was no, you know, no diseases in their world. They were pretty much perfect. And they had a simple process, you know, just don't eat the one tree. It's not really complicated, you know. And they had the Torah. I mean, God verbally gave it to them, so you know they were walking the Torah. And yet, they ate the fruit. You know, and it struck me, I thought, you know, hey, how does that apply to us? And it dawned on me that in our lives, every one of us, right? We look at our lives and we get so, I've seen people that they're so guilt-ridden. I mean, they're so guilt-ridden because they did this horrifying thing, right? And even in some of us, we may even still be carrying something that we don't even realize, well, I did that, I just can't believe I did that. Or I'm walking in this thing, this result of a sin one time, and it keeps bugging me, keeps stabbing at me. But God's saying, listen, if the most perfect creation fell easily, right? Then why do you think you're not going to fall? And it's not about the fall, it's about the restoration, right? Amen. You don't have to carry that guilt. God says what? He says, turn around, come back to me,
yeah.
Right? Right? You'll see a little more of this when we talk about Cain and Abel. But to me, that just struck me. He said, no, this world is loaded with guilt. I mean, the people are carrying burdens. I mean, I work in the workforce like most of you. And you see people at work. You see different attitudes, different things going on.
Yeah.
And just something little happens and a person blows off the steam, you know? And then in our world, you know, you got people coming around shooting people all the time now. I mean, there is heaviness. But the whole point here is we know the difference, right? Light to dark. We know the difference, the separation. We need to go to people we talk to and tell them they don't have to carry it. They need to realize that even if the most perfect people, how do you like that? First time I didn't shut my phone off. Hey God, I got you. I'm going forward. All right. But time to go. Wow, that took about 7. Anyway, bottom line, the most perfect people fall. We don't have to carry guilt because we're going to fall. God's saying flat out, we're all going to fall. Turn around, get right with God. Okay, so the covenant's broken, right? So let's go read Genesis 3:14 to the end. So funny, when I'm in small groups, I'm like, somebody read, you know, but this is like a big group, so how do you do that? I mean, one time he used to come here, Rabbi had a guy had a microphone. And I don't know what happened to that guy. Alan, you remember that? He used to have a guy in the corner over there, and every time something came up, the guy had to read everything.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what ever happened to him. He must have moved on somewhere else, but it just seems like, you know, okay, so-and-so, read such and such, you know? But it just doesn't work that way. Okay, I'm going. Then the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, you are cursed. Okay, now we're talking after she bit of the apple, okay? And so did Adam. You will crawl on your belly, groveling in the dust as long as you live. And I will cause hostility between you and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring. He will strike your head, and you will strike his heel. Then he said to the woman, I will sharpen the pain of your pregnancy, and in the pain you will give birth. And you will desire to control your husband, but he will rule over you. Isn't that true? Then to the man he said, since you listened to your wife and ate of the tree, whose fruit I commanded you not to eat, the ground is cursed because of you. All your life you will struggle to scratch a living from it. It will grow thorns and thistles for you, though you will eat of its grains. By the sweat of your brow will you have food to eat until you return to the ground from which you were made. For you were made from dust, and from dust you will return. You know, I thought that was interesting because in this you see that God developed three more covenants, you know, but only really one is applied to us, you know, but he kind of gave a three-for-one. You know, he told the serpent, right, first seed, right, seed of man is going to bruise your head, right? Then he told the woman, sorry, you're going to suffer in these pregnancies big time. And even though you desire to be in control, you're going to be ruled over. And then, of course, the man, he told you, well, he gave you good ones for the man. He said, you're going to fight, dig, scratch, crawl, and all that just to eat. You know? And you're going to suffer through all this. Now, here's the thing. Here's the thing that struck me. That's kind of the covenant. That's what you get. You get to, you know, if you do that, you know, that's all he told us. That's basically the end of it came. But really, the rest of it is the Torah. You know, he says, if you obey, right, if you obey my Torah, I will relieve your suffering. That's the whole thing. Not all of it, but the big gist of it. So that's kind of, that's called the Adamic covenant. You know, basically man is going to suffer, but man can get out of it if he obeys God. So with that though, you got to realize this. This is like the one thing I got out of this. He said the curse is a blessing in a sense. Now, I don't know, not to maybe think of a curse as a blessing, but you got to realize, you know, the curse is like a guarantee. Because bottom line is in your misery, you're going to look for relief, right? And you ain't going to look for relief from anywhere until you find the source that's going to give you relief, right? So that's the whole point. It's in that misery that we go to God. And when we go to God, what does he do? He says, hey, walk with me. And guess what? I will give you joy. I will give you peace. I will give you comfort. I will allow your fields to grow rich with crop. Your cattle to be, you know, your cattle to have multiple, you know, have grown great strength. God's telling us if we follow him. But this misery, guess what? This curse, you know, it's always so funny because you read later on in Deuteronomy, it talks about how, you know, if you don't do this, you will be cursed. Well, the truth of the matter is, you're already cursed. You know what I mean? The bottom line is, if you're not with God, guess what? Then you have that curse back at Adam, right? But then when you go to God, guess what? You get the relief. And that's pretty much what the Adamic covenant's all about. Now, from that process, right, we go on to Cain and Abel. Cain and Abel, chapter 4. Let's go ahead and read verses 1 through 5. It says, now Adam had sexual relations with his wife, Eve, and she became pregnant. When she gave birth to Cain, she said, With the Lord's help I have produced a man. Later she gave birth to his brother and named him Abel. When they grew up, Abel became a shepherd, while Cain cultivated the ground. When it was time for the harvest, Cain presented some of the crops as a gift to the Lord. Abel also brought a gift, the best of the firstborn lambs of his flock. The Lord accepted Abel and his gift, but he did not accept Cain and his gift. This made Cain very angry, and he looked dejected. Now, this is kind of the area you got a little more realization of the verbal Torah. They both knew or were taught what the offerings were for. They understood that you have to come with an offering of shedding of blood. This affected Cain, right? Cain was like, you know, I'm not happy about this. Well, let's read on a little bit more. So he goes here, he says, why are you so angry? The Lord asked Cain. Why do you look so dejected? You will be accepted if you do what is right. But if you refuse to do what is right, then watch out. Sin is crouching at the door, eager to control you. But you must subdue it and be its master. Now, in that little sentence there, there's an awful lot. I mean, the truth of the matter is, Cain blew it, right? Mm-hmm. He brought the wrong offering. Mm-hmm. And here's the kicker, right? God comes to him and says, all you got to do is the right thing. Mm-hmm. What does he say to us?
Do the right
thing. All you got to do is the right thing. Yeah. If you do that, guess what? I'll restore you. Yeah. Right? I mean, it's plain and simple. From the very beginning, he says the exact same thing. But if you don't, he says, watch out. Because sin wants to tear your hide up. And it wants to own you. And that's the kicker. It wants to own you. So God gave him the complete warning. And what did he do? He still went down that path. But I like the last word God said. He said to him again. He said, you must subdue it and be its master. Literally what he's saying is, when we walk in this Torah, we're walking back into sovereignty. We have authority given to us by God, take command over these items that fall under Torah. And we have to remember that. We have God's authority. We're not doing it in Sabrina's authority. We're not doing it in Brad's authority. We're doing it in the authority of Yeshua HaMashiach, you know, God, King of Kings, right? We're doing it in his authority. All right. Good, coming right to the red spot. Thank you for your patience. I'm not going to go too deep into Cain, the line of Cain, because obviously they don't make it very far. You know, once that flood happens, they're done. And then, of course, you know, there's the new birth, right? There's the new birth of Seth. You know, it's interesting about Seth, because guess what? She lost Cain because he was exiled. And she lost Abel. Mm-hmm. She lost both of them. Right, one big swoop. But then God gave her Seth. And God kind of talks about the line, the generational line. There's actually 10 generations between Adam and Noah. 10. You know, I looked at that word, and the meaning really comes down to it says, it calls it divine completeness, or divine fullness, completeness. And I thought that's kind of interesting, because what God is saying, and you'll hear in a second, is that he's got the whole thing wrapped up. This whole portion is done, right? Because we know what happens next to the flood. But this section is done. But hear the message that God gives in these names. I thought this was fascinating. Adam, right? The understanding or the meaning of Adam is man. The next one was Seth, and it's called appointed. Enosh is the next one called mortal. Then comes Kenan, and it's sorrow. Then Mahalalel, yeah, like that name. He's blessed one. And Jared will come down. Enoch is teaching. And Methuselah, that is death, will send. And then they have Lamech, the hidden king. And finally, we have Noah, which is rest. Now, the reason why I brought that out is because when you put them together, listen to what it says. It says, man is appointed mortal in sorrow, but our blessed one will come down teaching that his death will send the hidden king for our rest. Mm-hmm. Now, come on. You know what I'm saying? In God's word, man, it's message after message after message after message. It just goes on and on and on. That's why, take the time, even if you just do it on Sabbath, take the time. You know, get a humash, you know, do some whatever, but dig in. Try to get something in there, you know? Do some additional studies, anything you can do to grow, because the more you put inside you, the more God can use you for his service, for what he needs to do. With that, I'm going to close. Let's close with a word of prayer. Thank you very much for being patient with me.
That was really good.
And hopefully you got something out of it.
Very good. Yeah.
So I'll close the word of prayer. Dear Lord, just thank you so much for your love. And thank you for this time, Father. I tell you what, when I sit here and do this, Father, I mean, last time I did this, I was a nervous wreck, shaking the whole time. And this time I felt comfortable about it, but I still look at this and think, wow, Rabbi is really an awesome guy.
Amen.
And I just really have a lot of praise and honor for him. And you know something, he really deserves it. He does a wonderful job. He's a great leader. And each one of us should appreciate him very much. Father, I just ask right now that you'd just bless us with the rest of the service before we go home. And Yeshua's by